Father, that you make them, and who's them? Them is future believers. Them is like Christians at the First Baptist Church in 2020. Father, I pray that you make them one. You say, well, that's nice. That could go in a Hallmark card. It's, hey, we can one, you know, one love. We could be one. But he defined what one is. He says, as you and I are one. Like, how one do you think Jesus and the Father were? I think that's pretty one, right? I mean, like, you can't get any more one than Jesus and the Father. And so Jesus said, Father, I pray that you make them, future believers, Lebanese Christians, 2020, I pray you make them one as we are one. But then there's no period at the end of that sentence. There's a comma. And after the comma, he says, so that the world might know that you have sent me. Which means, please, don't miss this, which means the greatest deterrent to people believing in the Jesus of the Bible is when his own people choose not to love each other. When we choose to turn on each other for the sake of our sinful pride, showing ourselves to be more right in our pursuits rather than loving in our goals and dreams for one another, we give a reason for those who doubt to have their doubts. You're like, man, I just don't understand how anybody can make up your life without believing in Jesus. Oh, I do. Just watch enough churches. You okay? I told you wouldn't like this. Some of you can't handle this. Some of you can. So grab a hold of somebody maybe next to you that's about to leave. They need to hear this. So what do you do? What do you do? Well, I'd say you own your own response. Because that's all you really can do. So you can't wait for somebody else to get their junk together. Why? Because they're just as much of a sinner as you are. And you got so much going on in your own life, in your own heart. You should be overwhelmed with all that's on your plate to try to be changing someone else what's on their plate. So you just own your own junk. You own your own heart and your own response. As we've said, and you've been here at the First Baptist Church for any time, we say it a lot. You're only responsible for yourself, your response. You're only responsible for your response. So I'm going to give you some things that, again, most people are not humble enough even to consider. Most Christians don't have the spiritual maturity to walk in this, but I believe better about you, so here it goes. When you're dealing with conflict, when you're dealing with factions, when you're dealing with potential schisms, wars, personally, corporately, within the family, you need to ask yourself questions. Again, you will not want to ask, but you need to. For the sake of your walk with God and for the sake of you being everything Jesus wants you to be, you need to ask yourself certain questions. Question number one. Am I being a fool? Again, you never think of yourself as a fool. You think of other people's fools, don't you? I mean, you may not say the word because you heard Jesus say, don't call anybody a fool. But I'm telling you, in the book of Proverbs, Solomon, he calls a lot of people fools. And he tells you why you're a fool. Again, I quoted one already. Proverbs 18, verse 2. The Bible says, the fool does not delight in understanding, but only in revealing his own mind. Have you ever tried to work a conflict out with somebody and they did not want to listen to you, but they sure wanted you to listen to them? They didn't care what you had to say because they're smarter than you. They got the goods, maybe, what they think on you or on the situation. And they think if you would just see it from their perspective, then you wouldn't be foolish. And little do they not realize, the Bible says, when you don't delight in understanding, you're more concerned with being understood than understanding. So ask yourself the question, am I being foolish? Like in this conflict that I have I done everything within my power to seek first to understand rather than to be sinful in my pursuit of only wanting to be understood? Second question, and it's still in the same chapter, Proverbs 18. Now you're in verse 13. Second question, have I really done all I can to acquire the facts? Proverbs 18:13 says, he who answers a matter before he hears it, it is folly and shame to you. How many many times have you seen, and let's not talk about you because that's too close, but how many times have you seen other people step in it? They make judgments about a situation because they've heard something. But they've never gone to the source. They've never inquired for more. They just believe the something and feel like they know it all. The Bible says the person who does that, you're being a fool and you're acting shameful. I.e., stop that. Don't do that. But pride not only will lead you to a fall, pride will make you stupid. And I've seen people who are so smart get so stupid. Because you think you know it all, and you haven't gone to the source, you haven't gone to the person, you think you've got all the information, and thus you've made your puny judgments. And if you only saw it from God's perspective, if you only were open to seeing it from a non-fool's perspective, you would be so humbled because you'd realize you don't know half as much. So the guy, the gal who answers the matter before he hears it, it ain't the preacher saying you're foolish. It's not me saying you're shameful. It's the wisest man writing in the Old Testament. It's Solomon saying, you're foolish, you're shameful. You say, that's Proverbs 18? That's pretty cool. I ain't done. Proverbs 18 verse 17 says, here's another question you need to ask yourself. Have I formed biases based upon the first person who got to me that may or may not be true? Things that make you go. Verse 17 says, the first to plead his case always seems just until another comes and examines him. The first to make his case always seems right. Like, whoop. I know the story now. No, you don't. Because there's another side of that story. As your grandpa probably taught you, there are two sides of every pancake. And I'm just telling you this, what I've known now as a follower of Jesus for 30 years, there's more than just two sides. There's more than just your side and my side. There's God's side. Are you interested in that? You ought to be. Unless you're just full of pride and you want to be known as right. Which then begs the question, do you want to be right or do you want to be Christian? You say, I want to be both. Pick one. Pick one. Because you'll never go wrong being Christian. You'll never go wrong pursuing love and peace. You will go in the folly of pride and showing yourself to be spiritually immature, always seeking to be right because you'll never fail as a wrong. That might feed into your ego. That does not make your father proud.